Going to focus on an aspect of love that is lying fallow in this generation, and that is compassion. So my message is absent. Let compassion lead. Let compassion lead. Let's pray. Father, breathe on us one more time. Let your word lighten every dark place in our heart. In Jesus' name, amen. The Bible says in 1 John 4:20-21 that if a man say, I love God, and hateth his brother, is a liar. For he that loveth not his brother whom he has seen, how can he love God whom he has not seen? Verse 21. And these commandments keep we from him, that he that loveth God love his brother also. Beloved, the love of God and neighbor are two sides of the same coin. You cannot have one and neglect the other. The most authentic way of loving God is to demonstrate it towards your neighbor. And I'm speaking on compassion today. The single word that translates compassion is called suffering, which means feeling the pain of somebody and the desire to alleviate that person from his predicament. I want to begin today with a story I came across this week. And the story is that an anthropologist proposed a game to a kid of an African tribe. He put a basket full of fruits near a tree and told them that whoever gets there first will win the sweet fruit. And guess what happened? As he told them to run, they took each other's hand and ran together. So this made the anthropologist wonder, and he asked them why they did so, other than one running ahead of them all and having all the food for himself. But the answer they gave was very astonishing. They said, how can one of us be happy if all the other ones are sad? I repeat, how can one of us be happy if all the other ones are sad? Beloved, our strength in life is a function of how we uphold one another. Our true wealth is not determined by our qualifications or material possessions or the qualities we possess in life. Rather, it is determined by our peaceful coexistence and harmonious living. Nelson Mandela of blessed memory said, our human compassion binds us one to another, not in pity or patronizing, but as humans who have learned to turn our common suffering into the hope of the future. So what Nelson Mandela was saying was that to be human is to be compassionate. It is compassion that binds us up as humans. I know you can survive on your own. You can grow strong on your own. You can even prevail on your own. But you can't become human on your own. You needed the healthy womb of your mama to survive that 9-month gestation period before you arrived here on earth. Even Jesus needed the womb of a woman in order to fulfill his divine mandate of saving the world. How God anointed Jesus with Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. Acts 10:38. When Jesus received the anointing from God, he immediately went about doing good. He didn't sit in his corner. He didn't wait for the oppressed to come to him, but he went to them because he was turning with compassion to liberate humanity from suffering. The other day, when a man suffering from leprosy met him and said, Lord, willing. Let me be made whole. He gladly responded, I am willing. And one of the servants, he went and cured the man. Luke 5, 12, verse and 13. So I asked a simple question. What knowledge do you carry about the blind man who sleeps at the corner of the street? What knowledge do you carry about the destitute and the widow and the psychologically derailed? Do you despise them? Or you simply do nothing? The people of God, there come a time when silence is considered evil. True success in life is compassion driven. There was a time that a man confronted Jesus and said, Master, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus said, not that which is written in the law. Love the Lord thy God with all thy strength, with all thy might, and with all thy power. And love your neighbor as yourself. And the man, wanting to tempt Jesus, said, who is my neighbor? And I want you to turn your Bible with me now to the book of Luke, chapter 10, reading from the 30th verse to 37. The Bible says, and Jesus answered, said, a certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among thieves, which stripped him of his raiment and wounded him and departed, leaving him half dead. And by chance there came there a certain priest that way. And when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. And likewise a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, he also passed by to the other side. Verse 33. But a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came to where he was. And when he saw him, he had compassion on him, and went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring in oil and wine, and set him on his own beast, and brought him to an inn, and took care of him. And on the morrow, when he departed, he took out 2 pence, and gave him to the host, and said unto him, take care of him, and whatsoever thou spendest more, when I come again, I'll repay thee. Now, which of these 3 thinketh thou was a neighbor to him that fell among the thieves? Verse 37 says, he that showed mercy on him. And Jesus said unto him, go and do thou likewise. The priest and the Levite, who were agents of help by the law, couldn't have compassion on this half-dead man. They were preoccupied with their legalistic and rudimentary lifestyle. They had a form of godliness, but they denied the power thereof. If there is somebody who shouldn't have shown mercy or compassion on this wounded man, I suppose it should have been the certain Samaritan who actually did. Why am I saying that? Because the Jews had no dealings with the Samaritan at the time. That explains why when Jesus had an encounter with the woman of Samaria, the woman said to Jesus, how then can you, being a Jew, ask me, being a Samaritan woman, a thing? Because the Jews had no dealing with the Samaritan. John 4, verse 9. So why was it so? The Samaritans feel their worship is a true religion of the ancient Israel, proud to the Babylonian exile, preserved by those who remain in the land of Israel, as opposed to today. The Jews, however, see it as related, but altered and amended religion brought by those returning from the Babylonian exile. But the Jews regarded the Samaritans as ceremonially unclean, socially outcast, and religious heretics. Deciding to ignore the wounded Jew would have been a pleasure on the side of the Samaritans rather than an obligation. An additional animosity is this. Samaria became a place of refuge for the outlaw of Judah. What it means is that Samaritans willingly received Jewish criminals and refugees from justice. So the Jews regarded them as the worst of all human race. Anybody coming from Samaria was qualified as having a devil. John 8:48. So anybody coming from Samaria, coming from Samaria, was qualified as having a devil. And so the Samaritan man didn't only see a stranger, he saw an enemy and still went ahead and showed compassion on him. If it were to be today, I beg to differ, but most of us would have failed this test, especially in the neo-prophetic movement that we are in, which makes us suspicious of anything and anybody, even in the church. I like it when the Bible said that he went ahead and poured oil and wine on his wound. Now, I ask myself, why oil and wine? Oil and wine, because it has prophetic connotation. When you read the book of Revelation, chapter 6, from the fifth verse to the fifth verse, the Bible said that when the third seal was opened, a black horse appeared. And he that sat on the horse was given a pair of glass to measure the width and the belly. But he was given a clear instruction not to hurt the wine and the oil. So we see the wine and the oil appearing again. The black horse, black, symbolized darkness and sin. And he was given an instruction to measure the necessaries of life. Prophetically, this connotes a kind of famine that should invade the surface of the earth. When you read the preceding verse of the same Revelation chapter 6, it says that when the second seal was opened, a red horse appeared. And the red horse was given an instruction to kill one another. But when it came to the black horse that I'm talking about, it was given an instruction not to take the oil and wine. Prophetically, oil is a kind of grace. Let me say that anointed my head with oil. And wine prophetically symbolized love and cheerfulness. So when the Samaritan man was applying the oil and wine, he wasn't just applying oil and wine. He was making a prophetic call to a generation which will look beyond their differences and speak to love. He was talking about a generation where the love would dwell together with the wolf and they would not hurt or destroy one another. He was crying out for a generation characterized by so much love and compassion that famine and hardship would not have effect on them. He was not applying just oil and wine. He was prophesying to a generation where the line of demarcation between the have and the have not would not be easily singled out because of their love and their harmony for one another, where their pocket will not be a restriction for them loving one another, neither would their skin color or their status. It is not time for the sword, people of God. It is time for love. It is time for compassion. Are you the Messiah? Said no. Are you Elias? Said no. Are you one of the prophets? He said no. Then who are you? John the Baptist responded and said, I am a voice crying from the wilderness. Make up a way straight for the Lord our God. And I came to tell somebody that I am not the prophetic voice of our generation. I am not the major prophet of the nation. But at least I know that I am a voice of virtue. And this apostolic voice is crying and weeping in the borders of Ghana that let there be compassion. Let there be compassion. Become a voice to the voiceless. Become a father to the fatherless. Provide for the weak and the marginalized in society. Let us uphold one another. Let us go together. God sent me to this generation to restore the broken walls among youth and to inculcate virtue for personal character development. And I came to sound and shout this evening in the likeness of Prophet Amos that woe to them that are at peace in Zion. Woe to them that have neglected their duty to love. Enough of the cheaters. Enough of the sword. Enough of our mistakes. Enough of the limitation. Enough of the covetousness. Enough of murder. I need somebody. I can hear somebody saying that I need a person who will feed me when I'm hungry. who will lift me up from the pit. I need somebody who is not waiting for my downfall and make a sermon out of me, but somebody who will embrace me. For we have one God, one faith, and one baptism. One God and Father of all, who is with us all, and through us all, and in us all. The love of God is set abroad in our heart. God is love. God is love. And if God is love, man is a product of love. And it is love that determines our sustainability. It is love that determines our existence. And I hear God saying, just as I have loved you, love one another. Let compassion lead. Let love win. Do not judge others. That God will not judge you. Do not condemn others. That God will not condemn you. Do forgive one another. And God will forgive you. And people of God, the road to finding a true neighbor is to become one. As I am bringing my sermon to an end, I want to say something to add that one of the greatest enemies of compassion that we are dealing with in today's generation is discrimination. We have become so sentimental in our relationship. Our dealing with one another has been relegated to the grounds of investment rather than compassion. Before we do good to somebody, we are looking at either the temporal benefit or the future gain. So we live in a society where the poor has no voice. We live in a society of people who cares for the vulnerable. Widows are being maltreated in some part of the world. May I remind you, people of God, that the loss of husband in ancient Israel was considered a social and economic tragedy, but now it has been reduced to social fantasy and economic deprivation. We have neglected the commandment which says, "He shall not afflict the widow or the fatherless child." Exodus 23:22. And I came to make a call. The call of compassion is for us to stand against those who can't stand up for themselves. It is a call to cater for the needs of the weak and the marginalized in society. Compassion is not compassion until it is able to move your heart in motion. I want to admonish somebody that it is not too late to laugh. Just because someone disappointed you doesn't mean you don't have a reason to love again. You are bigger than that. And I want you to look around. Look at somebody. Put a smile on somebody's face. Give somebody a reason to live and love again. Become a voice to the voiceless. In the other day, I read my Bible. And Jesus said, the grounds of a certain man yield that much fruit. And he was contemplating on what to do. And he said to himself, this is what I will do. I will tear down my old towns and build a bigger one. And I will say to myself, take life easy. Eat, drink, and be merry. For you have stored enough food for yourself for many years. God looked at this man and said, you are a fool. Your soul will be demanded of you this very night. The man spoke as if he owns all of life. The man spoke as if he knows what will become tomorrow. He never acknowledged God in everything. A man can receive nothing except it is given to him from above. Look, I work hard. Is it my fault that others are broke and poor and miserable? What most people fail to recognize is that the source of all blessing is God. The source of all power is God. The source of all glory is God. And I wrote in my book and said, in the quest for multiplying wealth, most people have become fools in a world without compassion. And what do you do in such a world? The body rule says that people are would happen both to you. In other words, if you want peace for yourself, give peace to others. If you want love, give love to others. If you want affection, give affection to others. But we want to receive and we don't want to give. And that is where we miss it. Let compassion lead. Let compassion lead. I just want you to place your hand on your chest wherever you are and ask God that, God, fill me with your love. I know I love you, but cause me to love my neighbor. Because it is in loving somebody that I truly know myself. Speak to God right now. He's ever ready to listen to you. Talk to God. The Bible said in Ezekiel 36:26 that on that God has given you a tender, responsive heart. He said, I'll take away that old heart and give you a heart of flesh. You are not born again, you don't have that kind of heart. And so if you want to be born again, I want you to pray with me at this very moment and accept God as your Lord and personal Savior. Dear Heavenly Father, I come to you just as I am. I know I am a sinner. I acknowledge my sins before you. Father, touch me one more time. Holy Spirit, empower me to live a victorious Christian life. I declare the Lordship of Jesus Christ over my life. I declare that I'm born again. In Jesus' name, amen. If you said this prayer, you can find a Bible-believing church wherever you are. In fellowship with them. And I tell you, your life will never be the same. God bless you. Let's pray. God, I thank you for this sermon. I pray that let it gain root in our heart. Let the Holy Ghost remind us day in and day out that we may live with it thereby and put root in our life. Jesus' name. Amen. You want to phone in, then this is the number. You can phone in with 6145-77-1464. I repeat again. 6145-77-1464. You can also send us a text message on 6143-77-459. I repeat, you can send us a text message on 6143-77-459. Thank you, my wonderful listeners, for listening to Voice of Virtue broadcast. As I said earlier, I'm Michael Constant, the author of What You Can't Live Without, the Cardinal Virtues. I believe that you've been imparted. Your life is not going to be the same from today. I want to admonish you to go to Amazon, eBay, Google Books, everywhere, and search my book with my name, Michael Constant, or the book title, What You Can't Live Without, the Cardinal Virtues. This book will impact your life greatly. And the life will never be the same if you have an encounter with this book. I want us to pray one more time and thank God. Father, we thank you for this privilege. Let your will be done in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Beloved, I'm wrapping up and till we meet same time next week. The best is yours. Bye-bye.
Is the same God who is able to wipe your tears away. Is the same God who was there in time of lack and want. Is the same God, is Jehovah.
forever, my great provider. Tell me why you're giving up on God. Tell me why you're giving up on Him.